So welcome to the seminar on Diginomics in the summer term 2020. I guess we are all operating under very, very special conditions this semester due to the outbreak of the coronavirus that has led to very many, or if not all, teaching activities and test activities being shifted to the virtual space. And it's on sort of a general note, a very interesting phenomenon, because when you look into sociology, and Pierre Bourdieu is one of the big sociologists of all times, who's cited a lot in management research as well. Bourdieu basically says that industries are very, very stable, and they actually don't change quite a lot unless you have what he calls an exogenous shock, and then things sort of change very, very quickly. And it's interesting to see that in Germany, we've been talking about e-learning and stuff for almost or more than 10 years now. And then comes an exogenous shock. So like a virus outbreak like this is an exogenous shock for an industry. And then things change extremely quickly. So all the Eilentscheide and the quick shifting of even testings and exams to the virtual space sort of goes very much along with Bourdieu's ideas of change, which was very interesting for somebody like me who works a lot with sociological theory. And then I hope that we can, this semester, have the same productivity and the discussion culture in the seminar as we've had it in the personal space, and do the same thing here via Zoom. And we have a very, very good program, I guess, this semester with high-profile speakers from Harvard and other institutions. However, we also put a special emphasis on organizing talks by members of the group so that we can advance our projects and help each other out with framing our projects and advancing the research everyone's doing. So we start today with one of our own, Niels Stenter from the Institute for Project Management and Innovation, who will guide and lead us into his topic of patent management in times of blockchain technology. And Niels, I thank you very much for allowing us to test this entire virtual format basically with your talk. I think it's really, really good. And I would suggest that everybody except for Niels mutes himself now so that we have the best possible quality of hearing Niels' talk. And when you want to ask a question, just do the Handheben function. And Stefan, who's the co-host of this meeting, or I, who's the host, will see you, and then we can ask you to pose your question. But without further ado, I would now hand over to Niels Stenter and his presentation. And as usual, it's about, in terms of time, it's about 50-50 for the presentation and then the Q&A after that. And again, I thank you very much for coming here to the virtual space and giving your talk. I'm really much looking forward to that.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Wessel. And welcome from my side to my talk in the Diginomics Bromex seminar. My talk is about patent management and times of blockchain technology. I focus two things in my research. First, I'm interested in the applications of blockchain technology and patent management in the current scientific literature. And second, I investigate the potential of those applications from a perspective of a small and medium enterprise. However, the second objective is not part of this presentation because of time limitations, but feel free to ask in the discussion afterwards. First, I want to introduce my team I'm working in. I'm working at the Institute of Project Management and Innovation since the end of 2018. And here are some of my colleagues which supported me in the course of my time at the Institute, and of course, in the work of my paper. The teaching and research activities at the Institute of Project Management and Innovation roughly focus six directions. My paper is more focused on the top right, both directions. So innovation processes and evaluation and patent management. So let's dive into my topic. Perhaps many of you already read that blockchain technology will revolutionize the business world. maybe you read a newspaper article and or some advertisement on your smartphone. But at the current situation, we still do not see a great impact from the technology apart from cryptocurrencies. As our institute investigates the direction of patent management, we are familiar with the need for reliable documentation in the course of patent management and as well for the automation for contract processing. Because when you have a lot of contracts, the processing can be very much prone to errors and is very time consuming. Therefore, we conducted this research on blockchain technology in patent management or for patent management. When looking in the literature for applications of blockchain technology, patent management is only mentioned in the passing. Despite its huge potential for contract processing and immutability of documentations, which is highly suitable for patent management, studies only talk about the potential for patent management and fractions and do not consider its complete potential. Therefore, our first research question asks which applications of blockchain technology for patent management are covered in scientific literature. To answer this question, we conduct a systematic literature review on blockchain technology in the field of patent management. As I already mentioned in the introduction, I have another part of my research. Second, we ask ourselves, so what? Are these applications valuable for companies? To sharpen that question, we investigate the potential from the perspective of small and medium enterprises. So the analysis of potentials is aligned with the task and needs of patent management and the functions of and benefits from blockchain technologies. The second question is still in the pipeline and as I already mentioned, not part of this presentation. However, I would be pleased to discuss this question after the presentation. So I structured the presentation according to the paper in 6 parts. I already introduced the paper and the motivation behind it. In the next section, I will give an overview of the theoretical background of patent management and blockchain technology. Then we look at the used method, the systematic literature review. This differs from a normal literature review. The term systematic already indicates this. The method is based on a predefined research protocol, which increases transparency and reproducibility. Afterwards, I will present 2 exemplary results from the systematic literature review. And in the 5th section, we transfer the results into research on diffusion and technological transitions. Here we mainly use the multi-layer perspective introduced by Geertz in 2002. And finally, I will conclude the presentation. So let me start with the theoretical background for patent management. Schumpeter already mentioned in his work from 1911, the theory of economic development, that patents are mandatory for innovative companies to temporarily gain a monopoly. His idea behind patents was more or less the protection of intellectual property. So modern patent management goes far beyond this function of protection. For example, patents can function as an incentive for companies to develop novel ideas and invest in innovation activities. Or one can use patents to monitor his competitors and apply benchmarks. That's as well a research field we are doing at our institute. Therefore, patent management is not only the generation of a patent portfolio, but equally its evaluation and exploitation. As Bader et al. State, patent management can as well be thought as a life cycle model. Starting with the exploration of the patent landscape, we gain new ideas and insights in the patents of our competitors or of novel ideas. We fight against patent infringements and protect our patent portfolio in the step of protection. We optimize our patent portfolio, for example, by licensing in or the purchase of complementary patents, and we decline by abundance of patents or licensing out or selling patents, because if we have patents, the value of the patent might change over time and might be not that valuable anymore in the near future for us. But all these modern approaches still lack the information which functions or components are suitable for the own company and to what extent should those be implemented. When thinking about these functions, it's easy to see a connection between the managerial decision within patent management and the capabilities of a whole company. Maturity models are suitable for capturing the capabilities of a company. The objective of maturity models is to determine the current state of the development, to derive improvements measures, and to carry out performance benchmarks. Within the scope of maturity model, two types can be distinguished: capability-based maturity models and process-based maturity models. The major difference between both is the orientation considering input and output. The process-based model is purely output-oriented. That means the model aims for the best output, for example, performance duration of a process. The capability model is productive-oriented. Productivity is the ratio between output and input. Therefore, the basic consideration within a capability-based maturity model is to understand the change of maturity levels as an investment. In the context of the seven-dimensional patent management maturity model I will use in my further research, the input is associated with investment capital. The resulting output differs between the components and is dependent on the current state of the company. As I already mentioned, the relevant model for my research is the seven-dimensional patent management maturity model, which was proposed at our institute by Merle et al. The model consists of seven dimensions, which are more or less strictly isolated from each other. That means if a company sees the necessity to improve its patent intelligence, the other dimensions can be neglected in the first place. Of course, there are some supportive effects between these dimensions. For example, the dimensions culture and organization on the left sides act purely in a supportive way. In addition, each dimension serves to answer one key question. And within the elements of each dimensions, further questions need to be answered to identify the current state of those. Let's go into detail for the dimension generation. The dimension generation contains tasks which address the key questions: which patents should be developed. In this dimension are the elements application draft, application strategy, driver, and designer round. Each of these elements consists of further questions. When we look at the application draft, for example, this element is about the development of new patent applications. To be capable of this process, a distinct structure for responsibility and processes is helpful. In addition, the communication within the application draft is necessary. Inventors and developers need to be aware of the processes involved. However, this shows the distinct separation among these dimensions. Consider yourself a manager of a company which only buys and sells patents. For this type of business model, you don't need a focus on application draft or even the whole dimension generation. For this case, you would need a strong focus for the dimension exploitation, which comprises the commercialization of patents. This was the theoretical background of patent management. The seven-dimensional patent management maturity model serves in my research as the framework for my systematic literature review. Now I want to proceed to the second part of my research, that is the blockchain technology. I will give you only a non-technical introduction to this topic, as we already heard a presentation from Michel Raus last year about the details within blockchain technology. First of all, the blockchain technology is older than you might think. The technology combines a multitude of techniques which are very old in cryptographics. For example, the chain of blocks was already described by Hammer and Stornetta in 1991. The problem of consensus in distributed systems was already described by Lamport et al. In 1982 in form of the popular Byzantine generals problem. The basics for this problem, meaning digital signatures, were developed from Graham and Ryrest in 1978. And last but not least, the hash tree or Merkle tree was developed by Merkle in 1979, on which he held a patent until 1999. In research, there is already a broad range of applications, like in logistics to track the supply chain or cooling chain of goods, or recently in citizenship services. In the paper of Rieger et al., they implemented a blockchain for the German asylum procedure in Germany's Federal Office for Migration and Refugees. However, not every application is valuable. For this, I like to refer to the phrase of Maurizio Ferraris, an Italian professor for theoretical philosophy. He says the blockchain technology may help us to solve many problems, but we can be certain that it also creates many problems. This said, there are a multitude of challenges and limitations of blockchain technologies. I listed here a few of them. For example, the throughput on the left side. This is widely discussed, it's widely discussed the Bitcoin versus Visa throughput and scalability numbers. Bitcoin is capable of 5 transactions per second. Visa can handle almost 1,500 in the same period. Other problems are self-mining strategies and the waste of resources, especially coming up by the Bitcoin blockchain, by the mining in it. All these challenges and limitations let you think if a blockchain solution is really worth for your application. This question already asked and answered a multitude of studies. In addition, there is not only one blockchain. Each blockchain is different in its components. To differentiate them, there are 3 common architectures I will describe on the next slide. To find an answer on the proposed question, if a blockchain creates a value and which architecture of blockchain technology should be chosen, the usage of decision support tools may help. For this, Drescher and Lassity proposed basic questions like is a blockchain the right solution, or what is the added value of using the blockchain? But these questions are not that easy to answer if you're not familiar with the functions and benefits of blockchain technology. So other approaches may be more useful, like the decision path, which were proposed by Pedersen et al. And Wüst and Gervais. These decision paths comprise yes, no questions. And there you can see if a blockchain is really necessary or gives you a tangible value for your considered application. So let's look into the first decision path from Wüst and Gervais. I hope I pronounced that correctly. The first decision path consists of 6 yes-no questions. These questions follow the characteristics of blockchain technology. For example, let's look at the first question. Do you really need to store the state of the data? That means that blockchain technology focuses on the current state of your data you put on it. Or are there multiple writers? If there aren't any multiple writers, you don't need a blockchain. The path branches after question 4. This branching arises from the different architectures of blockchain technology I mentioned before. For example, if not all writers within the application are known at question 4, a permissionless blockchain can be useful. This is equivalent to the Bitcoin blockchain. This means every actor is allowed to read and write on the blockchain. If all the writers are known and you cannot trust each of them, you take the write permission from them with a permissioned blockchain architecture. Then we need to branch again regarding the permission to read the data. This results in a public permissioned blockchain in which everyone can read and only a selected number of actors can write, and in a private permission blockchain in which only selected actors can read and write. Another approach is from Pedersen et al. From 2019. Both approaches are quite similar to each other, but I mention this approach because the concept of smart contracts is illustrated within the decision path. Smart contracts are deployed on a blockchain and can automate contract processing. But to be able to implement smart contracts in a sustainable way, the rules of these contracts can only be adjusted in a minor way. Therefore, the transaction rules need to remain largely unchanged. That concludes the theoretical background of my study. Now let's proceed to the systematic literature review. This is the method I conducted. I select the systematic literature review as qualitative method to analyze the scientific research on blockchain technology for patent management. This method provides an exhaustive and reproducible way to analyze literature. The method is structured along 3 sections and 8 steps in total. The planning of the review is the first section. Here we formulate our research questions and develop and validate the review protocol. I already introduced my research question. So my question is, which applications of blockchain technology for patent management are covered in scientific literature? This question drives not only the first step, but the entire method of the literature review. In the second step, the review protocol is developed and validated in iteration loops. So the review protocol consists of every element of the review, including the purpose of the study or the already set research question. Then we have the search strategy, inclusion criteria, and so on. The review protocol makes the systematic literature review special in comparison to a normal literature review, as it reduces the possibility of researcher bias and increases the reliability of the review. In our review protocol, we define the scientific databases, the search queries for each database, as well as inclusion and exclusion criteria for each subsequent step. So let's proceed with the search strategies. For a search strategy, we choose the building blocks strategy from Maccioni in 1995. This means we build logical blocks of our 2 aspects, patent management and blockchain technology. For each block, we choose common keywords. Then we connect both blocks with an AND operator. Consequently, we get the intersection of both blocks. We search for this combination in Scopus, IEEE Explore, Web of Science, and Google Scholar. We use the tool Publish or Perish from Anne Will Hartzing to extract the results. In the course of our initial screening, we recognize a lot of noise in our data. Therefore, we build another block comprising noisy terms like internet protocol or IP address. We connect this block to our previous one. This time, we use an NOT operator. This concludes our research strategy. So conducting this research with the research strategy, we retrieve 431 articles in total. And as you can see, Google Scholar has by far the most records with 337. In the next subsequent steps, we reduce these numbers by manual assessment. Because the review protocol and conducting the review is quite redundant, I directly continue with the review. After we identified our literature, we need to screen for inclusion and assess the quality of the literature. This is again noted in the review protocol. We include each article we retrieved through the literature search. In the subsequent steps, we exclude the articles. First, we exclude duplicates, articles with missing access rights, and articles in other languages than English and German. Subsequently, we investigate the title, the abstracts, and eventually the full text. In case of uncertainty, we pass the respective article to the next stage. Doing so, we minimize the exclusion of a relevant article, or as you might want to say it, we reduce the number of false positives. we started with 431 articles. First, we clean duplicates, exclude articles. We have no missing rights off and articles which are of other languages than English or German. This results in 341 articles. Then we examine the title and abstract considering a proximity to blockchain technology. We noticed as well that a lot of articles deal with patenting of blockchain technology. The exclusion or inclusion of those results in 172 articles. In the assessment of the quality, we read the full text of the 170 articles and excluded 89. These articles show only a weak focus on blockchain technology or marginally address patent management similar to the studies mentioned in the introduction. At the end of our assessment, we result in 83 scientific articles. In the next step, we extract the data with the software publisher Parish. In addition, we classify the articles according to the content of the seven dimensions of the patent maturity model. We choose a deductive-inductive categorization to classify the articles. That means the deductive way comes from the seven dimensions of the seven-dimensional patent management maturity model. In addition, we identified a classification directly from the material or from the literature. This is the inductive way. This classification deals with the transparency for the patent system, as you can see.
Can I ask a question really quickly?
Okay.
So the seven categories from the model, the 7D model, and now your classification of the literature, is it your interpretation that you have sort of grouped the articles accordingly? Or how did it, so where do the numbers come from? How do the one-to-one in, mm-hmm. in culture, how where do they come from?
Of course, there's a lot of subjective interpretation in it, but we as well watch for specific terms of each dimension. For example, in generation, there are like terms, patent drafting, something like that. Exploitation is, of course, licensing in, licensing out. Yeah, we did it in a manual way. Yeah. Okay. Good. The time span of the results is from 2016 to 2019. And the focus is on the dimensions generation, exploitation, enforcement, and the inductively identified category, the transparency for the patent system. Next, we take a look into the results of the systematic literature review. For this, I picked the dimension generation as example. This dimension comprises 26 articles. And the articles deal with the concept of defensive publishing or open innovation. We identified 4 articles for defensive publication and 22 articles for open innovation. First, I want to give some basics to defensive publication. An invention must meet several requirements to be accepted for a patent. One of those requirements is to be novel and to overcome prior art. This requirement is exploited by a defensive publication. A defensive publication acts in a defensive way. That means we do not hurt our competitors with the publication, but we protect ourselves, we protect our freedom to operate. Therefore, the purpose of defensive publication is to expand the state of the art by disclosing an invention to the public. This raises the bar for competitors' patent application and protects the freedom to operate of a particular invention. But because it only acts in a defensive way, it should be considered as application strategy when the benefit of the patent monopoly does not make up for the cost of the patent, as Barrett in 2002 states. Some criteria must be met for defensive publishing. For example, the invention needs to be published as exhaustive as possible. The access to the publication must be available to the public, especially for one's own competitors. The invention must have a unique timestamp, and the invention must remain accessible from the time of publication and may not be changed from that. Traditionally, such public disclosure was established via printing publications that are made generally available to members of the public, like in a newspaper, you can even do it. With the advent of the internet, these definitions of what constitutes a public disclosure have been tested. So only a few platforms exist on the internet that meet these criteria, such as IP.com or Research Disclosure. However, the use of these platforms is cost intensive, and they are managed by a company and therefore vulnerable to manipulation and data loss. So in the identified articles in our literature review, they dealt with these problems. They propose a blockchain solution for defensive publication. This example here is from Sheets and Sheets. They propose an approach in four steps. In the first step, the inventor sends his ideas to the system. In the second step, the system creates a document of the ideas. It concatenates the ideas, applies a cryptographic hash function to the document, and places the cryptographic hash on a public permissionless blockchain like the Bitcoin blockchain. In the third step, the system stores the document on a public permissioned blockchain. And in the fourth step, the system periodically generates files, identifying and verifying the availability of all previous uploaded ideas, and places the files on a public permissionless blockchain, again, like the Bitcoin blockchain. Looking at the right column in the criteria of defensive publication, the first step makes it possible to publish the own invention as exhaustive as possible. That means you can put as much information in it as you want. In the second step, the invention is given a unique timestamp, which is immutable, secured on the blockchain. In the third step, the invention is and remains available to the public from the time of publication. And in the last step, which can be seen more as a monitoring step, the invention cannot be altered or changed without noticing. In this approach, we see two different blockchain architectures. The public permissionless blockchain serves as a service for a unique timestamp and thereof a proof of proof of existence or proof of ownership of the invention. The public permissioned blockchain serves as a database with writing and without reading restriction for the public. When thinking about publishing, the use case of scientific publishing is not that far away. In a recent work of Mohan, this idea is addressed. From my personal perspective, I really like this sentence, and I guess almost anyone can relate to this. Apart from problems with high subscription prices, restricted access, concerns about academic misconduct, and reproducibility, there is another source of dissatisfaction with the conventional publishing system that finds its way into many discussions on the value of decentralized scientific publishing. The oligopolistic nature of the scientific publishing industry and the profits of publisher. So in this citations, they don't really mention the blockchain as a word, but they mention the decentralized scientific publishing structure. So they mention a decentralized network, and maybe the approach of Sheets and Sheets can be as well applied to a scientific publishing industry. This concludes the results for defensive publication. Let's switch back to the results of the systematic literature review. As I already mentioned, another big aspect with 22 articles within the dimension generation is the concept open innovation. First, I want to introduce the concept open innovation. The concept was first coined by Chesbro in 2003. On the left figure, you can see the one figure of his work. You see two companies and you see a new market or a current market on the right side. And then you see all these bubbles. These bubbles can be considered as ideas or inventions. He considers as ideas. And you can see some bubbles that come from inside the company and remain in the inside. You can see bubbles that go from inside the company to the outside. And you can see bubbles that come from the outside and go to the inside of a company. So it is the counterpart to closed innovation. Closed innovation would mean you have ideas inside of your company and they stay inside of your company. That means that valuable ideas can come from inside or outside of the company. And in addition, these ideas can go to market from inside or outside of the company as well. But as we already learned in the theoretical background of blockchain technology, saying it with the words of Maurizio Ferraris, open innovation may help us to solve many problems, but we can certain that it also create many problems. In open innovation, we have more actors than within the closed innovation paradigm. That results in several challenges. First of all, we have an increase in transaction costs. As more actors participate in the innovation process, the question of responsibility or person in charge occurs. Then there is the free riding problem. That means outcomes that are created of collaborations of a multitude of actors can be exploited by actors which have given only little input. This is an imbalance between the results provided from an actor and those absorbed from an actor. When working with new coworkers, the first big issue that occurs is, of course, a lack of trust. In the best case example, there's already an established network of people which are familiar with each other, but it's normally that there's no experience of working between the actors, and therefore this big gap of trust occurs. Last, there can occur more communication issues in open innovation than in closed innovation because of the problems in before. So the papers in our systematic literature review deals with those problems. There were two different approaches. The blockchain technology can be suitable for open innovation in two types. So the first one is similar to the defensive publication. This approach is proposed by Schönholz et al. The authors use the design thinking process as the use case. The idea is to store every outcome of a collaboration on a public permissionless blockchain like the Bitcoin blockchain. Therefore, there's a common proof of existence and proof of ownership of the innovation outcomes. The free riding problem can be solved by clear denomination of ownership, and the same principle increases the trust among actors. The second type is the blockchain technology for process automation. Conventionally, non-disclosure agreements or NDAs are an appropriate tool to enhance the degree of trust and to avoid the problem of free riding, but NDAs are highly time-consuming and prone to errors. Several articles from our systematic literature review suggest applying smart contracts to automate these tasks. The smart contract is implemented on a private permissioned blockchain so that only the actors of innovation can read and write. In addition, subnetworks can be created by assigning group individual permission rights. Consequently, the blockchain technology provides more automation and less transaction costs, enhances the degree of trust between actors, and contributes to the incentive for participation. This reduces the ability of free riding for collaborating projects in open innovation. This concludes the examples of our literature review results. In the next section, we position the results in the research of technological diffusion and transition. We experienced the blockchain technology as a radical innovation for patent management. In the research on technological transitions, the multi-layer perspective on technological transitions introduced by Geertz in 2002 is a common descriptive model. It is illustrated on this page. We utilized this model to discuss the role of blockchain technology for patent management. The model consists of three layers. The socio-technical landscape is positioned at the macro level, containing exogenous factors which act as gradients for transitions. These factors can be seen as developments and cultural patterns, macroeconomics or macro politics. The socio-technical regimes are located at the meso level and represent the current structures and practices characterized by dominant rules, institutions, and technologies. The technological niches can be found on the micro level. The technological niches promote innovations that are fundamentally different from the prevailing regime. The regimes, the socio-technical regimes, are in itself stable. But if there are developments on the socio-technical landscape, the regimes feel tensions and aren't that stable anymore. This creates a window of opportunity for the niche innovations. Innovations may transit from their technological niches to the socio-technical regimes and achieve wide diffusion. They can even have an influence on the socio-technical landscape. We assign the different worlds within the field of patent management to the three layers. The socio-technical landscape remains equal to the definition of Krehl's. For the socio-technical regimes, we utilize a model of technology change from Adler and Schambach from 1990, in which different levels of organizational assets are discussed. Doing so, the socio-technical regimes in our model comprise five levels of patent management. We have culture, strategy, structure, procedures, and skills. The level procedure may contain the conventional procedure to apply for a patent in a specific country, or, for example, the conventional procedure to form non-disclosure agreements or licensing agreements with actors within open innovation. On the micro level, we position the technological niches comprising radical innovations. For the purpose of illustration, we market blockchain technology as successor of the window of opportunity. There are different reasons for tensions on the socio-technology, socio-technical regimes. Mr. Wessels already mentioned it, that maybe the COVID-19 virus is one of those. There are as well, for example, different behaviors of these tensions. For example, regular change or specific shocks. Another example would be the climate change for a specific shock. These different types of environmental change result in different types of transition paths. Krehl's and Schott from 2007 propose a typology of different transition pathways. For example, the reproduction pathway is the incremented change in the socio-technical regime, or the technological substitution pathway is the replacement of a technology by a radical innovation created in new socio-technical regimes. We predict different transition pathways for all depicted functions, data provenance, and smart contracts. Data provenance means that we deposit the hash of the state of data on a public permissionless blockchain, and therefore we get the proof of existence and proof of ownership for that data. Consequently, we secure the common state of the data and gain a proof of existence and ownership. The implementation of data provenance requires little effort and conventional procedures such as the data exchange via a network do not need to be changed. For this reason, we assume a transition in two stages for the function data provenance. In the first stage, the blockchain technology acts as a complement. This can be seen as the reproduction pathway. This means the socio-technical landscape changes in an incremental way and opens the window of opportunity for digitalization technologies. On the second level, the blockchain technology acts substituting. This can be seen as the technological substitution pathway. The storage and protection of data via separate technologies is redundant. Consequently, the blockchain technology substitutes the conventional database. Smart contracts provide automation for tasks that are repetitive and involve a multitude of actors. Accordingly, smart contracts automate already existing procedures. Using smart contracts in a complementary way to conventional procedures leads to redundant systems. Consequently, the blockchain technology follows the pathway of technological substitution in one step for the function smart contracts. That concludes the theoretical background for understanding of blockchain technology diffusion. Now let me conclude this presentation. The research provides a holistic overview of blockchain technology and patent management. Furthermore, we examine that not a single article considered patent management as a whole. That means only isolated approaches are presented, but no combinations or synergies are shown. For theoretical implications, we contribute to the research of technological transitions. Empirical research on recent technological transitions is limited. Renowned research is based only on historical transitions. As well, in further research, we want to provide implications for management. In the context of our potential analysis, we see an analogy to business process management, in which we conduct the process redesign with the help of blockchain technology. Our method is prone to errors. In the systematic literature review, there are potential biases like sampling bias or selection bias. Further limitation will be that we conduct the potential analysis only in a theoretical way. Data provenance, for example, is not evaluated in front of legal courts. In addition, complying with the General Data Protection Regulation of the European Union poses significant challenges and limitations for blockchain projects. This can become clear in the paper of the blockchain implementation for Germany's Federal Office for Migration and Refugees from Riga et al. For further research, we want to conduct a patent analysis to extend the proposed systematic literature review. Besides its semantic analysis potential, the bibliographic metrics allow an analysis of the players in that field. Another suitable idea for further research is to analysis the user acceptance for blockchain technology and patent management. A similar recent research was conducted by Wong et al. In the field of supply chain management. Yeah, thank you for your attention. I hope I could give you insight in my research on patent management in times of blockchain technology, what I'm currently doing, and I hope for a nice discussion.
Thank you very much, Niels.